ما شاء الله لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم حسبنا الله حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل نعم المولى ونعم النصير ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي جعل الحمد مفتاحا لذكره وسببا للمزيد من فضله ودليلا على علائه وعظمته ثم الصلاة والسلام وتحية والإكرام على النبي الأمي المكي المدني الهاشمي الذي سمي في السماوات بأحمد وفي الأرضين بأبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الأطيبين الأطهرين سيما أولهم أمير المؤمنين وآخرهم بقية الله في الأرضين روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء ورحمة الله على محبيهم ومواليهم وشيعتهم أجمعين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ملعونين أما بعد For the happiness of Hazrat Zahra-e Marziya For the enlightenment of the graves of your marhumin Of the graves of the shuhada, ulama and siddiqeen For the safety of the followers of Ahlul Bayt around the world And for the safety and the hastening of the reappearance of Hazrat Baqiyatullah al-A'zam Arwahun al-Fida Please recite your loudest salawat All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who's Rahman and the one who's Rahim. When we look at the period post-Karbala and the lives of the various imams, the life of Imam Sajjad salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi and his... And his imamat is one of the most difficult times that have passed for any imam. There are six different Umayyad Khulafa through his lifetime the imam lives through. But the longest of them is Abdul Malik bin Marwan. 21 years the imam was under Abdul Malik bin Marwan. And one of the most mal'oon from amongst all of the Umayyads. It is enough to say this about that individual, that he is the one that appoints Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi as his governor. Hajjaj is that mal'oon individual that he has killed thousands of Shia, thousands of Hassani Sadat, amongst them the Sahaba of the Prophet, amongst them the close companions of Amirul Mu'mineen. He is that sort of individual that he says to Abdul Malik bin Marwan, post-Karbala, he says, kill Ali ibn al-Hussain, kill Imam al-Sajjad as well. What are you waiting for? Just get rid of him. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is one of the latter Umavis, and nisbatan, compared to the earlier ones, he was slightly better. He stopped the sab of Amir al-Mu'mineen, he returned Fadak back to Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salam, but his imamat wasn't very long. And he says about Hajjaj, he says, لَوْ جَاءَتْ كُلُّ أُمَّةٍ بِخَبِيسِهِمْ وَجِئْنَا بِالْحَجَّاجِ لَغَلَبْنَاهُمْ Says that if all of the khabith, all of the worst and wretched individuals from all of history were gathered and placed on one side of the scale, وَجِئْنَا بِالْحَجَّاجِ And on the other side you placed Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, فَغَلَبْنَاهُمْ He would still be a bigger khabith, more wretched than all of these individuals. Hajjaj would not eat unless he had the head of a Shia in front of him. This is how bad this individual was. And he was the governor of Abdul Malik bin Marwan. And so Imam Sajjad alayhi salam is living through this time. And there are many different revolts, and it's a time of extreme turmoil within the Muslim Ummah. Many different revolts happened post-Karbala. You had the Tawabun, you had Mukhtar, yeah? You had the event of Harra, where Yazid ransacked Medina, the revolt of the people of Medina, in order to quash it. He ransacked Medina, kills over 2,000 people. The event of Harra was so bad that they said the following year, after the event of Harra, over 1,000 illegitimate children were born in Medina as a result of the actions of the army of Yazid. So you had the event of Harra, you had the rise of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. The destruction of the Kaaba happens. So all of these things, Imam alayhi salam is being forced to live during these times. One incident after another incident, absolute turmoil within the Muslim Ummah. And so in this time, the Imam is under constant watch. The Imam has no permission to hold any sort of classes. The Imam has no permission to meet with people openly and teach them. The Imam, even when you look at history, the Imam was never allowed to lead a single Jum'ah or Salat al-Jama'ah. None of this. This was all placed, all of the leaders or the Imams of whatever Jum'ah, Jama'at it was, came directly from Abdul Malik bin Marwan. So the Imam is living in this very difficult time. And so the Imam had to be innovative in how it is that he would do his tabligh. Why have I chosen this topic? The way the world is going, we are facing many threats, internally from amongst ourselves, and those from outside. And so it requires an individual to analyze the past. As we said previously, that Amir al-Mu'mineen says to his companion, Harith al-Hamadani, that I've studied the past and the civilizations of the past, and I've understood and I've read about them, we said yesterday, such that I have lived, it was as if I've lived amongst them. So looking back at history, understanding the various ways that this deen was kept alive is very important. And looking at the life of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, how the Imam did it in a more covert way compared to the other Imams is very important. Because many things, many attacks are coming within our communities, and many thoughts are being infiltrated within our communities against the aqa'id, against azadari, against, you know, these majalis and these mahafil that we have. And so it requires one to have a little bit of hikmah, a bit of wisdom and foresight to be able to tackle these issues that are coming. So what was the tabligh style of the Imam? We're going to highlight four different aspects from the life of the Imam, and then maybe try and draw, if we have enough time, some similarities in our times or how it is that we can tackle these problems. Recite salawat. The first thing, the first way that Imam Sajjad alayhi salam kept alive the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was by keeping alive the message of Karbala and keeping it fresh in the minds of the people. You know, when water would be brought to him, he would start crying. A whole day of fasting, and they'd bring water to him and he'd begin crying. Ya Ibn Rasulullah, why are you crying? قُتَلَ ابْنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أَتْشَانًا. They killed my father, Abi Abdullah, thirsty. They'd bring food for him. He would start to cry. Why are you crying? They killed my father while he was hungry. There would be different times, different occasions, different things would happen. One day the Imam is sitting amongst the people and a young boy comes running inside the room. And the Imam holds on to him, he kisses him. He says, do you know who this boy is? He is the son of my uncle Abbas. So Hazrat Abbas had one son that remained in Medina. And then he says, may the mercy of God be upon my uncle Abbas, because he gave his life in the way of his brother, and his arms were severed from his body, and now he flies in the heavens with two wings that Allah has given him. But these were all ways of tabligh that the Imam was keeping the message alive in the minds of the people. He would say to the people, there are three of the most difficult times upon us Ahlul Bayt. The first was at the death of Hamza Sayyid al-Shuhada, the uncle of the Prophet. That really broke the Holy Prophet, the death of his uncle. The second is at the death of Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, who was killed in the Battle of Muta. That when he's the brother of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and when he hears about the death of Ja'far, at that point Amir al-Mu'mineen says, my back has been broken. And Rasulullah, he's narrating while he's sitting with the companions about the Battle of Muta, as it was happening, he says, now Ja'far's arm has been severed, his right left arm has been severed, his right arm has been severed. And then he began crying profusely that Ja'far has become shaheed. And then he goes to the house of the wife of Ja'far, and the narration's there, he takes the children and the daughters of Ja'far in his lap, and he's placing his hand over their head, he's kissing their foreheads. And the wife of Ja'far, Asma, she says to him, Ya Rasulullah, you're acting in a way that people act with orphans. He couldn't bring himself to say it, tell her about the death of Ja'far. And so he looks at her and he says that Ja'far has been killed. He's been killed in the Battle of Mut, accept my condolences. And then he goes to Hazrat Zahra and he says, don't allow them to cook for 3 days. Send food to their house for 3 days. And this is one of the adab of the one that has lost the family member. Now in some communities we've made it that the poor person who suffered the death now has to feed everyone, rather than doing in the way that Ali Muhammad did in the Sunnah and the Seerah of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, that he says to Hazrat Zahra, send food to their house for 3 days. Make sure they don't light the cooker in their house. They're in a state of sorrow. So Imam Sajjad says, the second most difficult time for us Ahlul Bayt was the death of Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. And he says the third one was the most severest of them all, and that was the day that my father Abi Abdullah was killed in Karbala. So these are those different ways. The Imam is saying that he was killed in Karbala. So he was surrounded by 30,000. And here's the important part, and how low society has become. When we analyze the reasons for why Karbala happened, and that in itself is a whole ashra. Why Karbala? What led a community that was praying, that was eating halal, that was reciting Quran, that was doing everything, to go and murder in cold blood the grandson of the Holy Prophet? And not just just murder him, but the Imam says, "Kulluhum yataqarrabu ila Allah biqatlih." Says every single one of them there was hoping to get closer to Allah through killing Sayyid al-Shuhada. They were killing him qurbatan ila Allah. It's a very difficult thing to understand, that how is it that these individuals were willing to kill Imam al-Hussain alayhi salam, and then do it with the niyat qurbatan ila Allah. So the Imam used different ways to highlight, to remember Sayyid al-Shuhada, crying, keep alive the message of Karbala. At times people would come to him and say, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, why is it that you're crying so much? You're always crying. Ya Ibn Rasulillah, shahadat is your mirath. Shahadat is something that is in your blood. He says, Ya'qub lost one Yusuf. He had 12 sons. He lost one Yusuf. 11 sons were still with him. And he knew that his Yusuf was still alive. But he cried so much that he went blind. And then he says, and I lost 18 Yusufs in one day. And I saw all of their bodies lying there. So how is it that I should not cry? This was that form of tabligh. This azadari that we have. Don't just think of it like, oh, it's just something that we do. No, there is huge. Look at the book. Khasa'is hasn't been translated, unfortunately. Sheikh Jaffar Shushtari has a book called Khasa'is al-Husayniya. He compiles various narrations, various hadith in there in regards to the whole event of Karbala and the Azadari of Sayyidul Shuhada. But there are many other books that have been translated into English that talk about the importance of the Azadari of Sayyidul Shuhada, shedding tears for Imam al-Hussein, you know, walking or going on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein. All of these things, it is a way to keep alive this message. Now people are coming, oh no, we don't need this, we need to change it, we have to, you know, don't talk too much about the Messiah. I remember one place I was speaking to one of the other brothers, you know, the scholars, and he said, I went to one place and they were saying, you know, if you could just tone down the Messiah a little bit, it's scaring the kids. Do you see that these sort of thoughts that enter into the mind, and over generation after generation, you water it down to the point where now, you know, it's like, oh, okay, Azadari starts and everybody walks away. Because they don't understand the importance of that azar. They don't understand it. They don't, you know, there was no majlis during the time of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. There wasn't. It wasn't possible for the Imam to gather people to sit down. But in the time of the latter Imams, it was there. This is one other, you know, thing that people raise. Oh no, this majalis that we have and people sit down and they listen to the Masaib, this was never there at the time of the Imams. But it was. Look at Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. You know, after Imam al-Sajjad, during time of Imam al-Baqir, and then going into the time of Imam al-Sadiq, there were formalized gatherings of Azadari. Formalized. Kumait comes to Imam al-Sajjad in Mina, says, Ya ibn Rasulillah, I want to recite some poetry. Imam al-Sajjad says to him, Kumait, this is Mina. This is a place for you to get closer to Allah, not a place for poetry. He says, Ya ibn Rasulillah, it's in honor of Sayyidul Shuhada and in the musibah of Sayyidul Shuhada. Imam says to him, then Kumait for Imam al-Hussein, then recite here in Mina. Says, but wait, Imam sets up a barrier, a curtain of some sort, a tent of some sort. He gathers the women. He says, sit inside or sit behind this curtain. And he says to Kumait, Kumait, recite. And they say he began reciting the Masa'ib of Aba Abdullah. And Imam al-Sajjad began crying to the extent that the tears that were falling from his eyes were so many that the ground that was around Imam became wet with the tears of Imam al-Sadiq. When Kumait had finished his majlis, Imam went up to him. He raised his hands. He says, oh Allah, forgive the sins of Kumait from his past, and the sins of his future, and the sins that are hidden, and the sins that are open. Then Imam goes to all his family members. He says, whatever jewelry, whatever gold we have brought, bring it out. And he brings it out and he presents it to Kumait. Kumait says, Ya ibn Rasulillah, I didn't do it for the money. Allahu Akbar. Kumait was hur. Hurriyat. If you want to see hurriyat, look at the sha'ir of Ali Muhammad. Kumait is the one when Sakina bint al-Husayn, not the small Sakina, but another Sakina bint al-Husayn, when he goes and he recites the Masa'ib for, in her gathering, she writes him the title deed to a huge garden that she owned. And he was like, no, I don't want it. Abdullah ibn Ja'far, when he calls him, and he recites the Masa'ib of Abi Abdullah. Abdullah ibn Ja'far gives him thousands of dinar. Kumait says, no, I won't take it. He's hur. Imam al-Sadiq says to him, look, Kumait, I know you don't take it. But this is from us. It's a gift from us. Take it. Those that are the zakir of Sayyidul Shuhada, Those of you that recite the Musibah, that recite Marthiya, recite Noha, recite the Masa'ib, understand your maqam. Understand your position. And then those that are the azadar of Sayyidul Shuhada, understand your position. Innal Hussain babun min abwabil Jannah. Hussain is a door from amongst the doors of Jannah. Sheikh Abdul Karim Al Ha'iri is the individual who established the Hawza in Qum. Marja. They say that one night Sheikh Abdul Karim Al Ha'iri, he sees in his dream Yawmul Qiyamah. And he sees himself in a line with all the scholars, grand maraji, all lining, waiting up to go into heaven. But there's a line next to him of normal people, normal individuals, all lined up next to him. And Amir al-Mu'mineen is at the front of it. And one by one, he's calling them all through, and with speed, they're entering into Jannah. He says, I walked up to Amir al-Mu'mineen, said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, what is this line? Says Sheikh Abdul Karim al-Ha'iri, this is the line for those to enter into Jannah through Bab al-Hussein. These are those people that were the azadar of Imam al-Hussein. These are those people that were the zakir of Imam al-Hussein. These are those people that would arrange the niyaz, that were volunteers, that would set up the majlis, that would invite people to come and take part in the majlis of Imam al-Hussein. They are those that attended the majlis of Abi Abdullah. They are entering into Jannah through this line, for this is Bab al-Hussein. Sheikh Abdul Karim al-Ha'iri says, I went back and I became very upset. I said to one of the people in the line of Bab al-Hussein that I wish I could be in there with you. He says to me that Sheikh Abdul Karim Ha'iri, come stand behind me and recite the Masa'ib of Abi Abdullah. I will, and you too will be from amongst the Zakir. Sheikh Abdul Karim Al-Ha'iri says that in my dream I went and I stood behind this man and I recited the Masa'ib of Ali al-Asghar. At that moment Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, I cried, this man cried. When I'd finished the Masa'ib, Amir al-Mu'mineen looked at me, said, Sheikh Abdul Karim al-Ha'iri, remain in the line of Bab al-Hussein. Says, I woke up all of a sudden. And after that day, Sheikh Abdul Karim al-Ha'iri is the only marja taqleed at that time that would first recite the Masa'ib of Aba Abdullah before he started his Dars al-Kharij. Don't consider that these majalis that we have, they're just something that we put together and we're copying our elders, and they need reformation. Don't let this seed enter into your mind and fester, because it is a seed that has been placed there by Shaitan. You go to Imam al-Radha's time. Now during the time of Imam Radha, it was formalized at a government level, because Imam was Wali Ahad of Harun. So it was formalized at a government level where Da'bil al-Khudai comes and he recites his poetry, and Imam says to him, 1 second, Da'bil. And he places a curtain in the way and he calls the women of Ali Muhammad as well and says, Da'bil, recite. And Da'bil recites the poetry, and it's very famous, has one line, أَفَاطِمُ لَوْ خِلْتِ الْحُسَيْنَ مُجَدِّلَ وَقَدْ مَاتَ أَجْشَانِ بِشَطِّ فُرَاتِ. This famous poem of Da'bil, he recites, and the Imam says to him, Da'bil, these words are not from you. Those of you that are poets of Ali Muhammad. Says, these lines are not from you. You have been inspired by Ruh al-Qudus. The Imam sits there, he cries on that marthiya that is recited by Da'bil. And then when he finishes, Imam says, bring for me my shirt. And they bring it for the Imam. He presents it to Da'bil. He says, Da'bil, this shirt, I have recited 1,000 nights of Namaz-e-Shab in there. And I have, while wearing it. And I have done 1,000 Khatm al-Quran while wearing this shirt. Da'bil, this is for you. And then he gives Da'bil 100 dinar. Da'bil takes the shirt, says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, I don't want the money. I don't want the money. I didn't do it for the money. I didn't do it for the money. Imam says, no, Da'bil, we are giving it to you. We know you didn't do it for the money, but we are giving it to you. And so he gives that money and the shirt to Da'bil. So this formalized version of Aza was very much present. But in the time of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, it was very difficult. The Imam couldn't do anything. He was unable to hold these majalis. Da'bil was hur. He wasn't bound by money to recite the musiba or to recite the poetry of Abi Abdullah. He was hur, free. He wasn't tied down to anything of this world. He understood what the masa'ib of Imam al-Hussein does for a person's akhirah. What the tears of Imam al-Hussein do for an individual's akhirah. So Imam al-Sajjad, the first way was through these tears for Sayyid al-Shuhada, by keeping alive the message of Karbala. The second was through encouraging people to go on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein. He would say to them that if anyone considers, anyone makes small of, anyone who belittles the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein, hadith from Imam Sajjad says, anyone who belittles or reduces the importance of the ziyarat of Abi Abdullah, it is as if he has reduced the importance of God. And then he says, Man dhara al-Husayn bi Karbala ka man dhara Allah fawqa arshih. It is the one that goes on the ziyarat of Imam al-Husayn in Karbala, it is as if he has done the ziyarat of God on the arsh. It's not that Allah sits on the arsh. We know that, you all know that. Our aqaid is stronger than that. But he's showing the azama, the greatness of the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. The one who goes on ziyarat, all his sins are forgiven. The one who goes on ziyarat with ma'rifah, Jannah becomes wajib upon him. All your du'as can be answered in Karbala. The latter imams would push it. Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, when he fell ill, some people came to visit him and Imam said, oh, I've heard that you're going to Karbala. And they said, yes, we are, Yabna Rasulullah. Imam al-Hadi gives him some money. He says, when you go to Karbala, stand under the dome of my grandfather, Abu Abdullah, and do dua for my shifa'ah. They leave, they go. And then one of them says, wait, isn't Imam supposed to be the Hujjah as well? Why is he asking us to pray for him? So they come back. Ibn Rasulullah, you're the Hajjah as well. Why are you telling us to go to Karbala to pray for you? He says, because look, Allah has appointed certain places and certain times and certain months for the ijabat of dua. Certain du'as are accepted quicker at certain times, in certain months, in certain places. And one of those places is in Karbala. So when you go Karbala, you'll see a hadith that's inscribed around the haram in various places that says, oh Hussein, you gave everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so Allah gave you three things in return: shifa'ah in your turba, imamat in your lineage, wa ijabatu du'a tahta qubba, and the acceptance of du'a under your dome. There is no limit to the amount of du'as you can ask when you are there in Karbala, and they will be accepted as long as you stand under the dome of Imam al-Hussein. Not just in the precincts of the Haram, no. Go next to the Dari, make sure you're under the dome, then ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then tell me whether or not your du'as were accepted or not. So Imam was pushing people to go on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, look, even if you can't afford to go on the ziyarah, take a loan, and we are the guarantors of that loan, and we will pay that loan back for you. We will aid you in the paying back of that loan. That's not, you know, some people are multiple loan takers. You know, just go to one person every year, just keep on accruing loans. No, it's with a little bit of aql. He says, go, if you can't afford it, don't worry, take a loan. We Ahlul Bayt are your guarantors. We will repay your loans. That's how important the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam is. Now we have riwayat that say an individual who had the means to go on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein in his life, but did not go on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hussein, did not make an effort to go on that ziyarat, and he died, he's died a munafiq. So, hadith like this, a person needs to really think that, oh no, it's not just a holiday that we're going on. No, there are whole adab for Karbala. Don't eat meat while you're there. Don't eat anything sweet. We have different riwayat that talk about the adab of going to Karbala. Now, unfortunately, we've gone so much that it's just become just one of those things, right? Now I know where all the good takeaways are and all the restaurants are and where the good places to get good souvenirs. Sometimes when Allah gives us a ni'mah, we become complacent. We've gone so many times, we become complacent. That fervor that I had when I first went is gone. No, I don't have that passion anymore. It's something to be worried about, something that a person needs to concentrate and think. Or then I go and I've been so many times, and I said this the other night at the Mehfil, and those brothers that are there will apologize. I will apologize to you that I'm repeating myself, but I think it's important that the people will go, and they'll go so often that now they'll get to places like Sahla and Kufa, and then they'll just be like, okay, quickly, two rakat here, let's get it all ticked off. Because that's the way that we've done it. Make myself feel good, tick the box. I did Sahla, I did Kufa. But it's not ibadat. That's not ibadat. Does that show my love? Don't show my love. I dare say if my wife gave me a list of things that, okay, I need you to do this, you know, fulfill it, and I just rush around and haphazardly do everything and be like, there you go, I did it all, and now I can go get something to eat, or I can go and see my friends. I wouldn't dare do that there. But when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to my ibadah, when it comes to Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, yeah, quickly, I need to go see my mates. I need to fit it into my lifestyle. So the second thing that the Imam did is encourage the ziyarah of Sayyidul Shuhada. The third thing that the Imam alayhi salam did is that his form of tabligh, because he couldn't openly do tabligh amongst the people, the Imam at times would have gatherings pretending that they were gatherings of Quran, because Imam alayhi salam was known to have the most beautiful voice in Medina in recitation of the Holy Quran. And from amongst all the other Imams, it's one of the things, one of the characteristics of Imam Sajjad was the beauty of his recitation of the Holy Quran. And so what would happen is just before Fajr, before anyone came, the Imam would gather with a few people and would whisper and teach them a few things. And then as the Mu'adzin would come to give the Azan, one of them would recite Quran loudly, or the Imam would recite Quran loudly, so that the people would think that it's just a Quran class. One of the other things that the Imam did was, at that time there were many conquests that were happening, different parts of the world, and prisoners of war were being brought towards Medina and they were being sold. So the Imam would go and buy these individuals from those that were selling the prisoners of war, bring them into his house, keep them as his equals, and he would teach them about the deen, teach them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, train them in the religion, and they would live equal with the Imam. Same in the time of Imam Radha alayhi salam, he wouldn't sit down to eat unless all the servants that were working for him would all sit down at the table with him and eat. So Imam Sajjad would train all of these individuals, and then Eid al-Fitr or some occasion he would free them, and then would go and bring more, and then train them for a year or so, then free them. According to some of the historians, Imam in his lifetime, post-Karbala, the Imam is alive 34 years. In that lifetime of 34 years, the Imam freed 50,000 prisoners of war. 50,000 slaves the Imam freed. And they weren't just normal individuals. You know, one of the stories, there's an individual by the name of Abdullah ibn Mubarak. He says that there was a drought in Medina. And people were going out and they were reciting the namaz for rain to so that the rain would begin to fall. And for days and days, nothing was happening. He says, I saw a slave and he was sort of walking around. And he walked to a corner and he fell in sajda, and there was something that attracted me towards him. So I went closer to listen. What is it that he's saying? And he says he's got his head on the ground and he's saying, my Lord, these people are suffering. I won't raise my head until you send rain. He says at that moment, rain clouds appeared and the rain began flowing all over Medina. A heavy rain. Says he lifted his head and he began walking. Says I ran after him, seeing who is this slave, where is he come from. Says I saw him enter into the house of Ali ibn al-Hussain. Says I went to the house of Imam Sajjad. I was saying, I just saw one of your slaves that was here. He did this and I want to buy him from you. And the Imam said, I don't know which one. Eventually they found him. He was one of the stable hands of the Imam, would take care of the horses of the Imam. And he went there and he says, look, I want to buy you from Imam Sajjad. And this slave, he looks towards him, he says, then why? He says, because I saw what you did when you were in Sajjad. I want to learn from you. I don't want you to be my slave. I want to learn from you. I want to benefit from you. Teach me that, teach me that which you know. The slave, when he heard these words, he raised his head towards the sky, said, my Lord, my agreement with you was this, that for as long as the people didn't find out about the position that you had granted me, I would remain within this dunya. But my Lord, I don't want to go around with people knowing what my position is. My Lord, take me now from this dunya. There and then his soul is removed from his body, he dies. That the maqam, that understanding that these individuals had under the tutelage of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, that they were taught the haqaiq, the realities. These individuals became absolute, you know, had huge control over the Holy Quran. And so Imam was doing this, 50,000 in his lifetime, and each of them would go and then gather their own companions as well, and then teach them what the Imam had taught them. And so in this way, the ilm of the Imam spread all over the Muslim world without the enemies even knowing. The fourth thing that Imam alayhi salam did was that he taught the deen, and you know this, through dua. Sahifa Sajjadiyya of the Imam alayhi salam is not just a book of dua, it is all of the durus of the Imam. I don't know how many of us have actually picked up Sahifa Sajjadiyya. How many of us have read Sahifa Sajjadiyya? It's unfortunate that those that are not the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam are more attached to these things than we are. George Jordak, the famous writer of Assault al-Adalat al-Insaniya, the voice of human justice, the Christian from Lebanon who died some years back, he wrote that book, Assault al-Adalat al-Insaniya. For 40 years of his life, he spent it writing, he used his pen, writing about Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Not even a Muslim. He says that I have read Nahjul Balagha at least 200 times cover to cover. What about me? Amirul Mu'mineen, he takes Kumail out into the desert. And Kumail says, Ali sighed. I said, Kumail, ha huna ilman jama'a. Points to his chest. Says, ha huna ilman jama'a. Says, Kumail, there is so much knowledge that is gathered here within my chest. But Kumail, there's no one to take it. Ali was madhloon then, at the hands of his enemies and those that had hasad. And Ali is mazlum today. There were people there out of hatred didn't want to hear Ali's words and his teachings. But today Ali is mazlum at the hands of his own Shias. That I have Nahjul Balagha in my home. I have Nahjul Balagha in my phone. But how many times have I read it? How many times have I read what it is that Amirul Mu'mineen was saying? How many times have I read Sahifa Sajjadiyya? The words of my Imam. The sermons of Zainab alayhi salam, the sermons of Imam Sajjad, the sermon of Fadakiya. How many times have I read it? I come, I cry for the musibah of Sayyidah Zainab. I come and I cry for the musibah of Sayyidah Zahra. I come and I cry for the musibah of Imam Sajjad. But what is it that they were actually saying? I don't know. So then how is it I'm Shia? With what face will I face my Imam? The du'as of Sahifa Sajjadiyya, you look at them, each of them. The du'as for parents, du'a number 25, says that it's a total lesson in how one should act towards their parents. The du'a for children, a complete lesson in how one should raise their children. The du'a makarimul akhlaq, a complete lesson on morality of an individual. But how many times have I read it? Laylatul Qadr once, mashallah, if I get time, I'll recite du'a makarimul akhlaq. How mazloom is Sajjad? His Sahifa Sajjadiyya is filled with all of these lessons. All I need to do is pick it up and read it with the translation. What is it that Sayyidah Sajjadin was asking? Because Zahiran he was asking Allah, but in the batin of it, he was giving us lessons. He would hold on to the Kaaba and beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But through those supplications, he was teaching those around them. One of the things that you will notice in the du'as of Sahifa Sajjadiyya is constant salawat upon Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. Constantly recite loud salawat. That the Imam was constantly reciting. He's interlaced every other line or every paragraph of every dua. You look at dua makarim al-akhlaq. After every section, this salawat. And all the other duas are like that as well. And the reason being, because at that time, they were trying to separate the al, they were trying to separate them from the Holy Prophet. And so here in his duas, Imam is forcing this point. Because from day one, from the moment that the eyes of Rasulullah closed, people were looking to separate Amirul Mu'mineen and Imam al-Hasan and Imam al-Hussain from Rasulullah. And this is why Sayyidu Shuhada, when he's leaving Medina and he writes that letter to his brother, or he leaves that will with his brother Muhammad al-Hanafiya, وَإِنَّمَا خَرَجْتُ لِطَلِبِ الْإِصْلَاحِ فِي أُمَّةِ جَدِّي. You all know it. He says, how is it that you will do Amr bil Ma'aruf and Nahy anil Munkar? He says, وَأَسِيرُ بِسِيرَةِ جَدِّي وَأَبِي عَلِي ابْنِ أَبِي طَالِبِ. That I'm going to walk upon the seerah of my grandfather and my father Ali, in order to show that there is no difference between the seerah of Rasulullah and the seerah of Ali. When he's riding out into the battlefield for the last time, he says, "Ana ibn Ali al-Tahri min Ali Hashim, kafani bihadha mafkharin hina afkhar." That I am the son of that pure Ali from Bani Hashim. If there is anything Hussein should be proud of in his life, or could be proud of in his life, this one point is enough for him, that he is the son of Ali. Because over and over, they were trying to reduce the greatness of Amirul Mu'mineen. They were trying to reduce the greatness of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And they were trying to reduce the greatness of the Al. And so Imam al-Sajjad interlaces it. Because the importance of Ahlul Bayt was being taken away. That's what Ibn Abbas, he says to Sayyidul Shuhada, when he's leaving, he says, Ya Abna Rasulullah, don't go. Don't go. Because if you go and they kill you, it will remove any sort of hurma, any sort of honor, or any sort of position that anyone associated to you will have. You know, they won't maintain the honor of anyone else. Because if they're willing to kill the Hujjah of Allah, they're willing to kill the Imam, then what are the Shias or the followers or the family members? Then they have no hurma. And that's what you see, that these individuals, they kill the Hujjah of Allah, and then for them to do what they did after is not a problem. You know, see the event of Harra happening. What? It doesn't matter. We killed Hussain. We brutally murdered him. You know, Abdullah ibn Hanzala and his 8 sons killed. Kumail, Qanbar. These people don't care. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, history. Then once you've killed the Hujjah, then the Hurma of everyone else is nothing. And so when they had killed Abi Abdullah in Karbala, what honor would they have given to Sajjad and the women of Ali Muhammad? What umid does one have? What hope does one have that they would have honored the daughters of Ali and Zahra? 34 years he cried. 34 years. But there was one place that made him cry more than anywhere else. When they asked him, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, where was the place that the most amount of musibah befell you? What was most difficult for you? Was it when your Ali Akbar fell to the ground, فَقَطَّعُوهُ إِرْبًا إِرْبًا? When your Ali Akbar was mutilated as he lay upon the ground? Was it that when they severed the arms of Abbas and fired an arrow into the eye of Abbas, and they mutilated his body, was that the most difficult? So that wasn't the most difficult for us, Ahlul Bayt. Was it when Abi Abdullah fell to the ground and they ran horses over his body, crushing his ribs into his back, separating his limbs from his body? Was this the most difficult for you? He says, no, this wasn't the most difficult time, Ya Ibn Rasulillah. Then when was the most difficult time for you? And he would say, Ash-Sham, Ash-Sham, Ash-Sham. That Sham was very difficult for us, Ali Muhammad. This is why when on the day of Ashura, when Imam al-Hussein comes to bid farewell to Imam al-Sajjad, and Imam al-Sajjad, seeing the state of his father, tries to stand up to go out and fight, says, Auntie, give me my asa and give me a sword. Says Sajjad, what will you do? He says, do you not see the state of my father covered in wounds, blood all over his face? I will use this asa to support myself. I will use this sword to fight. At that point, Imam al-Hussein says to him, Sajjad, my son, this is not your battle. Sajjad, your jihad will be far greater, Sajjad. You will see the daughters of Ali and Zahra paraded. Nu'man ibn Manzal al-Mada'in, he says to Imam al-Sajjad, says, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, why is it that you keep saying, Ash-Sham, Ash-Sham, Ash-Sham? What happened to you in Sham? Imam says to him, Nu'man, there were a number of things that took place in Sham that did not happen anywhere else. Says, the first thing that happened to us, Nu'man, is that when we got to the gates of Sham, they took the heads of all the loved ones, of all the shuhada from Bani Hashim, and they placed the heads in front of the women. They placed the head of Qasim in front of Farwa. They placed the head of Akbar in front of Layla. They placed the head of Abbas in front of Kulthum. They placed the head of Hussein in front of Zainab. Says that the women were forced to look towards the heads. They say when they wanted to enter into the city of Sham, they said that Sayyidah Zainab called Shimmer, said, "Oh Shimmer, if you're going to take us into Sham, then at least place these heads in front of us so that the people are busy looking towards the heads and then we can pass without being looked at." No, instead they took the heads and they placed them next to the women so they would look towards the heads, then look towards the daughters of Ali and Zahra. Says, "Oh Nu'man, they would play with the heads while they were on the spears. At times the heads would fall onto the ground and they would be crushed under the feet of the camels." The second reason, Nu'man, is that when we entered into Sham, they called drummers and dancers to drum and dance around the daughters of Ali and Zahra. The third reason, Nu'man, the women of Sham, they climbed upon their houses and they would throw boiling water and set fire to pieces of wood and throw them on the daughters of Ali and Zahra. The fourth reason, Nu'man, is that they took us to the marketplace of slaves where they tried to sell the daughters of Ali and Zahra as slaves. The fifth reason, Nu'man, is that they took us to the area where the Jews and the Christians lived, and there they announced, "These are the ones that killed your elders in Khaybar. Come and take your revenge from them." Not a single one remained in the house, except that they came with sticks and stones in their hands, and they began to beat the daughters of Ali and Zahra. The last reason, Nu'man, is that when we were in Sham, they kept us in the house of ruins, a house that had no roof, a prison that had no roof, such that during the day, the daughters of Ali and Zahra and the children of Hussein would suffer from the heat of the sun, and at night there would be no solace from the cold winds of the night. Nu'man, that is the place where my beloved Sakina lies. Ala la'anatullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيُّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, for the sake of these tears, forgive our sins. Ya Allah, forgive the sins of our parents. Ya Allah, those of our parents that are alive, give them long lives. Those of our parents that have left this world, give them a place next to Ali Muhammad in Jannah. Ya Allah, those who are ill, give them shifa'ah. Ya Allah, those who are in debt, clear their debts. Ya Allah, give us tawfiq to go on the ziyarat of Abi Abdullah this year and every year. Ya Allah, keep our ulama and our maraji' at the head of our institutions. Give them long and healthy lives. Ya Allah, keep safe the azadar of Sayyid al-Shuhada around the world. Ya Allah, hasten the reappearance of the Imam of our time and allow us to be amongst his true muntadreen, Matamir Hussain.